This is Inside the Jungle, episode 201, recorded July 1st, 2015. Do the Bengals need another wide receiver? Video bandwidth for Inside the Jungle is made possible by the support from our Patreon community. To help support Inside the Jungle today, log on to spnt.tv/Patreon. Good morning, good evening, good afternoon, wherever you are around the world. This is Inside the Jungle. It's the Wednesday night roundtable. We're back for another episode here. Live at CincyJungle.com. I'm Nick Suberling, hanging out this week with the best in the biz, if you ask me, folks. The one and only Anthony Cosenza and Scott Bantel. Scotty B, beam me up, man. How you doing?
Hey, Nick, how's it going? Happy early birthday to America today.
That's right. We're getting there. It's coming up on a big 4th of July weekend. You got big plans?
Just the normal. Doing a little parade, some grilling out. Hopefully the weather holds up.
Hopefully. We live in Ohio, man. That doesn't happen. We'll see. Of course, we also welcome back Anthony Cosenza over on the left coast. AC, man, what's going on? You got big plans for the 4th?
Not particularly. I have the day off of work on Friday. Going to probably set some posts and, I don't know, maybe a little golf. I'll be a tourist and go to the beach probably on Saturday like everybody else out here, and then maybe a little barbecue in the evening type of thing, kind of standard stuff, but looking forward to it. Glad I got a day off.
I think I go to the beach on the weekends too.
Weekend warrior?
Yeah, the beaches. There's all kinds of beaches here in Ohio.
Yeah, I've heard they're world class.
Well, I don't know. I got nothing. Well, we're glad you're both back this week. Mickey, he's hanging out. He's at a concert tonight. I think it's AWOL Nation. I think I'm not familiar with the if that is that a band name, AC? That shows you what kind of loop I'm in. Alright, so he's at the AWOL Nation concert in downtown Cincy tonight. So he is out this week. Hopefully we'll be back with him next week. First we'll start off the show. I gotta say thank you to everybody who went out and gave us some feedback about last week's episode, our big 200th episode with Jeff Hobson from Bengals.com. The emails came they came pouring in. The tweets came pouring in. So thank you for your feedback, and glad to see that we've made an impact on a lot of you out there that listen to the show. And it's cool to see the fact that people took the time to say thanks for what we do, and I'm thanking you for the feedback, so thanks. I mean, Casey, that episode last week, I mean, it was one of the longer ones we've ever done, but I think probably probably the best interview we've ever had with Jeff.
Yeah, it was. I mean, he spent 45 minutes, an hour with us, so I mean, that was pretty awesome. And I think the only shows that we have done or that I have been a part of that have been longer have been the draft shows. So I enjoyed it immensely. I'm narcissistic and like to listen to the show and download it after we do it. So I got a kick out of it, and I've you know, he threw out a couple of tidbits. We'll probably talk more about that throughout the show, but I've kind of created a couple of posts out of those for the website just because he was so candid with his answers, and always appreciate that.
What about you, Scott? I mean, look, we love talking to Jeff, but I know that having him on, it's really cool, and I love the fact that, just like AC said, he opens up and speaks his mind. He's not afraid to say what he thinks about the team, even though he's a team employee. He's employed by the Bengals. But, you know, he kills it every time he comes on.
Yeah, I've got the chance to talk to him a couple of times now, and I think we talked about last week. He's the type of guy that you'd love to just sit at a bar with, you know, belly up to the bar, have a couple drinks, and just talk football for hours. That's the type of guy he is, and he always gives some great information.
Yeah.
We just got to get a certain ESPN reporter to call the podcast by name, right?
Oh. Exactly. I thought you were supposed to cite your sources. Maybe ESPN doesn't abide by that.
Yeah, that was interesting. I guess it's good to know that ESPN listens to us, right?
That's right. That's right.
Pretty cool. So, yeah, good stuff again last week. If you didn't catch it and you want to download episode 200, the quick address to get to that, spnt.tv/200, that'll send you right to our article over at cincyjungle.com with the audio. So make sure you check it out there at the jungle. All right, part of the discussion we had last week with Jeff Hobson dealt with the receivers. And Jeff, when we asked him about the receiver group, he flat out said he thinks they need to get another receiver out there. I know Scott disagrees with him, but I'm going to kick it over to you first, AC. Your thoughts on the comments, and who could they even be looking at possibly if they do need to get another one?
Yeah, I don't think, and he said this too, I don't think they're looking at someone right now in the exact present moment. I think this is probably something that they look at after final cuts are made or further cuts are made, and maybe a surprising guy ends up being out there for whatever reason and can come in and contribute. I think obviously everyone's a little gun shy because of what happened to that position group late last season. I mean, into that, we've talked about it a number of times now. I mean, in that playoff game against the Colts, there was just nobody for Andy Dalton to really throw to that was a true legitimate threat, either at tight end or at wide receiver. I mean, they made do where they could, but I mean, it wasn't really a scary offense that they put out on the field. So, obviously, you want to have a contingency plan. I think everybody sounds like they're healthy, according to Hobson, so that's good. I like their top three, obviously, the top three wide receivers they have. But, who knows? Maybe the Alford kid surprises. Maybe James Wright takes a big step this year, and that's not going to be an issue. But some things have to play out in training camp. And if they do add somebody, it'll probably be later because they do make moves towards, after final roster cuts and stuff. I mean, that's how Brandon Tate landed on this roster and other players too. So they do tend to be a little active at that point.
Oh, my favorite player, Brandon Tate. Scott, you disagree with what Jeff Hobson had to say last week. Why is that?
Well, I mean, I look at it, if you just look at it from a strict number standpoint, you got your top three, Green, Jones, and Sanu. And again, this is assuming everyone's healthy. And I know that's kind of dangerous. I know that's what got them burnt last year with Jones. We kept hearing, wait till Jones is back, wait till Jones is back. And maybe that's what he was referring to along the lines of, look, we can't bet on everyone being healthy and being 100%. You know, we've got to bring someone else in the chance that they're not healthy. But for the sake of the argument, let's assume they are. If you got Green, Jones, and Sanu, are locks, your last three generally are going to have to give some sort of special teams contribution, which you're probably not going to get out of a veteran that you pick up in free agency. I doubt they cut a guy like Wright. As long as he's healthy, he was contributing both offensively and special teams last year. I doubt they cut Alford, because I don't think he would make it to the practice squad. So I doubt they cut him. That leaves one last spot. And I think Denarius Moore, is an interesting candidate. I mean, he had a good year in Oakland under Hugh Jackson, and he really hasn't had good quarterback play. Some Bengals fans may laugh about the quarterback play, when we're referring to Dalton. But the fact of the matter is he's a solid quarterback who can get the ball to Moore, and Moore can make some things happen. And then on top of that, you've got a guy like Burkhead that they're trying out at slot receiver. So I just don't see where another receiver really fits into this roster.
That was the name, Denarius Moore, that we didn't really hear Hobson mention last week on the show. I'm wondering, AC, if that's maybe because what was seen of him through the OTAs and minicamps, maybe he wasn't all that impressive, and he seems to think that he won't be somebody sticking around.
Yeah, he lumped him in a group of players that he said weren't really stepping up. He mentioned Moore, and that was really, unfortunately, the only time he mentioned him. And he also mentioned Kobe Hamilton and a couple of other players in that same vein. So, those two guys, I kind of was hoping that they would get something out of those guys. And Kobe Hamilton now, I think he's in his third season, and he's really not taking the steps, it sounds like, that they were hoping for, even though he was a low-round pick. And Denarius Moore, he's a Hugh Jackson guy, and you would hope that he would find a place. But I don't know that they're impressed with him as a kick returner by the sounds of things. And I don't know that he's really making a huge impact at wide receiver either. I think a lot of stuff has to see, I mean, you got to see these guys in actual action and in preseason games and in training camp when things are kind of going at least near full speed to really gauge it. But You know, if one of those top three guys goes down, it could be a little sketchy, especially, I mean, when Hobson says so, too.
Well, you have the list of free agents, potential free agents, I guess the current free agents right now.
I do, yeah.
That's not including guys we think might get cut in training camp.
Right.
Obviously, we can't predict the future, otherwise that'd be fantastic if we could. So is there anybody on that current list of free agents that you're looking at right now that screams to you, okay, I could see him being here?
Not particularly. I mean, there's some decent names out there. I mean, there is the Dane Sonsenbacher, but Hobson, when Mickey asked him about that last week, he kind of poo-pooed that idea a little bit. So yeah. I think that one's kind of going by the wayside there. There's Mike Williams, formerly of Buffalo. There is Wes Welker, but he's had a number of concussion issues. I don't know if anybody really wants to touch him because of that. Reggie Wayne is out there, but I mean, he's 14th season. I don't know, you know, I don't know what you're going to get more out of him. Santana Moss, same thing. Josh Morgan, Lance Moore, Robert Meacham, Brandon Lloyd, and then there's good old Greg Little as well. I mean, those are some of the names out there too. So nothing that really screams immediate impact, and that's probably why those guys are out there. Teams are kind of waiting to see if somebody gets hurt, or maybe they just end up grabbing one of those guys on the cheap as more time passes.
You know, if to me, Scott, if you can get somebody like Reggie Wayne at an affordable cost for 1 year, I think that might be something you explore. I mean, the guy's got playoff experience. He's a winner. One of the best receivers ever in the NFL. I mean, going to easily be in the Hall of Fame. Would you even consider taking a flyer on him? I mean, at least, if anything, you know he's going to be somebody good on third down.
Yeah, I mean, I mean, taking a look at that list, there's no one that jumps off and really excites you. But, you know, I would take a flyer. You know, I would take a flyer on Wayne. You know, worst case scenario, you see he's got nothing left in the tank. You let him go. The other guy that does intrigue me, I forgot he was still a free agent. So if Hobson wants to sign this guy, I'm all for it, and that would be Welker. You know, I know he's got the problems with concussions, but I'd sign him to a 1 year deal, you know, as a slot guy. And I think the one possibility is, you know, Sanu, it's possible that they could use him as trade bait in the preseason. You know, if someone needs a receiver, a number two, you know, if Jones is healthy, you know, I think a guy like Alford or Moore are probably better slot guys than Sanu. And, you know, it's possible they could trade someone like Sanu for a late round pick. You know, because I don't think next year Jones and Sanu are both free agents, and I don't see any scenario where they sign both of those guys next year. So I take a look at it and say, okay, which one do you want to keep? And if you're able to get some of them for one of them this year, maybe you do that and you sign a guy like Welker to take his place. And I'd go for that.
I mean, it's interesting. I don't know if that's something that they'll explore or do. I mean, it's pretty rare when the Bengals I couldn't even tell you the last time they actually made a trade in the offseason. The only one that kind of jumps out to me, I guess they traded for Kelly Jennings a couple years ago.
They traded for Reggie Nelson also.
And then again, how long ago was that?
That was 2010, I think, yeah.
Right. I mean, it's a good thought, especially if you think, if you know you're not going to get both guys back in the fold the following year, and you can get a draft pick for him, Scott. I mean, that'd be nice. I just don't see the Bengals doing that. You and your conspiracy theories, man. I love them. You are those are the best.
Well, I mean, if you take a look at it just from an organizational standpoint, if you're not going to sign both of them, and like I said, I don't see any scenario where they do, you know, why not try to get something from them instead of letting them leave next year? I don't think, you know, if you let Sanu leave via free agency, I don't see him landing you a comp pick, or if it is, it's going to be, you know, sixth, maybe seventh round. So, you know, if Jones is healthy and you like what you got in Alford and Wright's healthy, you know, why not leverage him into a fourth or a fifth round pick? And, you know, maybe you do take a flyer on a veteran like a Wes Welker or a Reggie Wayne.
Well, let's bring that, you know, let's explore that a little deeper, AC, because obviously the big one that everybody's talking about is AJ Green getting his deal done. But again, when you've got two guys like Jones and Sanu or free agents at the same time, Scott doesn't think that they're both going to get signed. I actually think that they'll make it happen. I don't think Sanu's going to command a whole lot of money out on the free agent market. And the Bengals, you know, they value him pretty good, and they do a pretty good job of re-signing their own guys. But do you think they both can get done, and that way you keep all three, hopefully, in the fold?
Well, that's a tough question, because now you're looking at your top three wide receivers that are entering free agency. I think Green's obviously their top priority. I think they're going to do whatever they can to hang on to him. Some people agree with that. Some people don't. I think probably in all likelihood, Green will likely be initially tagged, franchise tagged, and then maybe they start working out a long-term deal from there. I think they do like both Jones and Sanu. They both bring two different things. I get where Scott's coming from, but I don't really like the idea of bailing on one of those guys this year for a guy that has a number of injury issues, concussion issues, who's smaller, quite a bit older, and you get maybe a lesser draft pick than maybe even where you drafted Mohamed Sanu in the first place. So I see the rationale on one side, but I think if they're going to let one of those guys walk, you might as well get the one last year out of them and let them play in a system that they're accustomed to and do their thing. I actually think that Sanu is actually better suited as a slot guy in this offense than he is an outside guy, and I think a lot of people have said that. You know, I think that was kind of, even though he made some plays on the outside filling in for Green and Jones last year, I think he's more comfortable on the inside with those two guys on the outside garnering more attention, and Sanu can kind of take the shorter routes and get some yards after the catch type of thing. So I don't know. I like that trio. I hope they can find a way to keep them all together. It's going to be difficult to keep all three. I definitely think they keep two. Which two, I don't know. Three is a possibility, but it's going to be difficult.
I just don't see Sanu commanding a large market out there. Unless he goes out this year and has a 10-touchdown year like Jones had a couple years ago. I don't see that happening. First of all, there's not enough balls to go around in this offense for Sanu to have 10 touchdowns. You know, you add the fact that you've got two really good tight ends now in Croft and Eifert, as long as they stay healthy. And if Jones stays on the field and is healthy, we know what he can do. So I just don't see him commanding a lot of money out there on the free agent market. And by the way, why would you want to get rid of or trade a guy that just nailed a 60-yard field goal? Did you see the video of Sanu kicking a 60-yard field goal? I mean, that's impressive. The guy can do it all.
A soft spot in Nick's heart, a man that can kick a field goal.
You know it. Kickers rule, man. 60 yards, though. I mean, come on. Give the guy some credit.
It's pretty legit. That was very surprising. I mean, talk about a guy who can seriously do a little bit of everything. I mean, he's kind of being a social media wonder here. He's sinking baskets from off of his balcony and kicking 60-yard field goals. He's thrown touchdowns in the NFL. He's caught touchdowns in the NFL. It's kind of crazy.
So not only do you have an emergency third quarterback in Sanu, you've got an emergency place kicker a la Ocho Cinco. Oh, man, those were the days as well. So, yeah, I think they need a receiver right now? No, I think they're pretty set. Now, if something happens in training camp, by all means, they're going to have to go and get somebody. You cannot put the responsibility of that number three spot to somebody like Denarius Moore or James Wright, who we know can't stay healthy either. But if you're Wes Welker, could you imagine if the Bengals signed Wes Welker? He goes from Tom Brady throwing in passes to Peyton Manning throwing in passes, and now Andy Dalton throwing in passes. Wow. A rough life for Wes.
And Nick, bashing Dalton already. I mean, the season hasn't even started. We got hashtag McCarron in the chat room. We got Nick throwing this guy under the bus. Man, Dalton just can't saying, win.
Just saying, you're going from two Hall of Famers, two of the greatest of all time, to that. But it's not going to happen. Wes Welker is not coming to Cincinnati, folks. It's just not going to happen.
No, I'm going to rate us back in from the Dalton conversation really quick, and I just think if they are going to explore it, and Scott, I didn't mean to interrupt you, but if they are looking at a wide receiver, I think it's going to be someone who's no more than a number four type of guy. That's just what I think. I think they're hanging on to those top three guys this year, and they're going to maybe search another guy that could contribute as a fourth guy. But that's me. Anyways, what were you saying, Scott?
Well, I was just going to throw out, you know, we talked about, you mentioned Sanu being a better fit in the slot in this offense, which may be right, but the only thing that concerns me about Sanu in the slot is, you know, when you look at a slot guy, you want a guy that, that has very good hands, and Sanu drops a lot of balls. If I remember correctly, he might have led the NFL in drops last year. He's not a guy that's particularly fast. He's not a guy that's particularly quick or good in space, you know, so he doesn't really, you know, fit the bill of what you really want or look for in a slot guy. You know, I think that, you know, that's where I think someone like a Wes Welker, maybe a Denarius Moore, or even that Mario Alford guy may fit better in the slot.
The name of the what's the extra draft they have? It's escaping my mind. I can't remember the name of it.
Supplemental?
Supplemental. No. Thank you. I think they go supplemental, baby. Go get a receiver in the supplemental draft. No? Okay.
Maybe they're waiting for Terrell Pryor to get cut in Cleveland now that he said he's a wide receiver, just to bring him back.
I don't think he's getting cut in Cleveland because he's probably one of their most talented players on that roster right now. And that tells you what you need to know about those Brownies, right?
Might be the most talented quarterback on their roster.
Oh, poor Cleveland, right? All right, next topic. We beat that. I mean, look, if you think there's a receiver out there in free agency that you want the Bengals to sign, I'd love to hear from you. Feedback inside the jungle at spnt.tv is the email address. Let us know who you think they should sign. I've seen a couple here in our chat room. Somebody threw out Robert Meacham, which is intriguing. I don't know. We'll see. Let us know who you think they should sign, if anybody. Again, inside the jungle at spnt.tv is that email address. All right, so it's the off season, so we get these articles, it seems like, twice, three times a week. But hey, four Bengals make the All-AFC North team, according to NFL.com. So, you know that they're putting this trophy up on their mantle. Kevin Zeitler, Andrew Whitworth, AJ Green, Geno Atkins. They're going to hoist that trophy and show it off proudly that they are in the All-AFC North team, guys. Yay! What do you make? I mean, these articles are great. Obviously, those are probably the four best players on this, four of the better players on the roster. I wouldn't say the four best, but four of the better players on the roster, at least at their positions. Is there anybody that you think maybe that was left off that should be in this list? AC, I'll throw it over to you first.
It depends. I mean, Now that Ed Reed and Troy Polamalu are out of the division, I mean, I think Reggie Nelson is a very underrated player and has been since he's been with the Bengals. So he just doesn't get the fanfare of a lot of other players, but he's been a very solid, solid player all around for this defense and in that secondary. I mean, that's one guy. Obviously, Burfict's another, but he was just so injured last year, I think he kind of fell by the wayside. So those are two others that I can think of just off the top of my head.
How about you guys? Is there anything that are you surprised at the four that were listed? And is there anybody else on this team that you think probably should be getting mentioned?
No, definitely not surprised at the four that were mentioned. If you look at snubs, I'd say I agree with Anthony, Reggie Nelson. I mean, I would say Reggie Nelson's the best safety in the division. Certainly better than Dante Whitner or Hill. You know, I would think after the season he had last year, a guy like Ioloka would have an argument for being on that team as well. And then the other one, I wouldn't have expected him to get it over Le'Veon Bell just because of name recognition. But you take a look at the last eight games of the year that Jeremy Hill had and compare that to Le'Veon Bell, and you'd be hard-pressed to say that Bell was the better back. I mean, I think the last eight games of the year, Jeremy Hill might have been the best back in the NFL. So I think he would have a legitimate argument of saying that, hey, you know, I deserve to be the running back on that team.
That's a good call, Scott. I mean, Hill was awesome the last half of the year, and you just kind of wish, man, I wish they would have just realized it a lot sooner, AC. You look around, and obviously the Steelers are the Steelers, so you know they're going to get their love from all the national pundits. But outside of Bell and Hill in the division, I don't know if there's really anybody else really worth mentioning at that the running back spot. I couldn't even tell you who the starting running back for the Baltimore Ravens is right now.
Right. They've had their issues at that position, and it's funny because the Ravens. What's that?
Just a little bit.
just a little bit. A little guy named Ray Rice had some issues, but it's funny because they used to be the grounded pound, solid defense type of team, and they've adapted a little bit. And to their credit, they've still done very well, even without that running game. But you know, the Browns were very surprising in a positive way, running the football last year with kind of a 2-3 headed monster. But there's not really one guy that stands out on that roster, and like Scott said, Jeremy Hill, it was a very Corey Dillon-esque, if you remember Corey Dillon's rookie year. You know, he kind of broke out that last half of the season and basically won a lot of games for that Bengals team that was really struggling. He was Boomer's last year. He came back to the Bengals that last year, and he ended up, those two guys ended up starting the last half of the season and won a lot of games for the Bengals. But Hill kind of had a similar deal as a rookie that Dillon did and really broke out the last half of the season.
Yeah, I mean, Justin Forsett had a good year last year with the Ravens. I don't think he would have an argument to be on that team over Bell or Hill. But you know, that's a guy that had a good year, and I didn't verify, but I'm pretty sure that he re-signed with the Ravens.
Yeah, but see, that's what you need. That tells you what you need to know, though. I off the top of my head, Justin Forsett's not screaming to me like great running back in this division. You know what I mean?
Right.
But yeah, he did have a good year. Fortunately, the Bengals did a pretty good job keeping him in check last year. Outside of AJ Green, I don't know if there's any. I mean, obviously Antonio Bryant in Pittsburgh is another one of those receivers in the division that is easily going to make this list. Is if they're just going with two receivers, and those are obviously your top two in the division. If they were to have a third, though, AC, does Marvin Jones have a claim?
He has a claim. I don't know how big of one he would have. I think a lot of people are starting to fall in love with Martavis Bryant with the Steelers and Marcus Wheaton even also. There's a couple of guys on the Ravens that people like as well, but Torrey Smith is now gone, so he's not there anymore. But I think both Jones and Sanu would have a claim, but I mean anywhere near the two guys that you mentioned, Antonio Brown and AJ Green.
This just goes to show you how much I don't care and dislike the Baltimore Ravens. Is Steve Smith Sr. still there? Because if he is, he's probably your third best.
Yeah, he is. I mean, he, to his credit, he still contributes, still makes big plays, and I don't think he's where he was in his prime, anywhere close with the Panthers, but he's been a good little Band-Aid for them, but I still don't think he's up there with the other two as well.
He does like to push off.
Well, the article actually has him on the team. They have three receivers, and Smith is the third receiver.
Oh, boom. There you go. See?
There you have it.
So, yeah, he does like to push off, though. OPI. Is that, anybody remember that? Sorry about your luck there. So, I mean, you can't argue with those three. I think that's a pretty solid group. Obviously, your quarterbacks, Flacco and Roethlisberger. Andy Dalton, I guess you can give him honorable mention for third team, maybe. I don't know. But, I mean, I think with the list that they've created, again, this is the offseason. You need to fill space. So you can't argue with what they've done as far as who the Bengals are on this list. Zeitler, Whitworth, Green, and Atkins. And, yeah, I think it's a good list. So check it out. We'll provide a link to this article in the show notes this week over at The Jungle. All right, our last segment, our last topic of the week. Dre Kirkpatrick, fan favorite. We know John from Kentucky loves Dre. He's probably wearing his Dre Kirkpatrick jersey as we speak. But he was on the Rich Eisen Show this week and had some interesting comments about the team. What of particular interest, though, he was very candid about Andy Dalton versus A.J. McCarron. Now, let's remind everybody that Dre and A.J. McCarron were teammates at Alabama. So Dre's pretty tuned in to how AJ can play and knows what kind of a competitive guy he is, on the practice field and during games. But even he says right now it's Andy's team. Do you make anything of this, guys? I mean, I know there's a lot of people out there clamoring for getting A.J. McCarron into that starting role. I mean, there's a couple guys in this chat room right now who have already mentioned it. But, Scott, I'll throw it to you first. Are you surprised by the comments that Dre made regarding Andy Dalton versus A.J. McCarron? I'm not surprised.
No, I mean, the only thing that surprised me is the fact that he said, it's Dalton's job for now, almost insinuating that, it's kind of Dalton's, but McCarron could take it. I say this all the time on this podcast, in my articles, around the water cooler. Let's not forget, A.J. McCarron may end up being a good quarterback one day. A.J. McCarron has exactly zero wins in the NFL. He has exactly zero passes in the NFL, zero touchdowns. I mean, the guy hasn't even thrown a preseason pass. I mean, we have people that are wanting to anoint this guy starter over Andy Dalton, a guy that has 40-plus wins in the NFL, 4 playoff trips in 4 tries, and one division title. So, I mean, let's slow this horse down about there being any sort of competition. This is Andy Dalton's job, and unless something dramatic happens, I mean, dramatic is in Andy Dalton forgets how to throw the football. Andy Dalton's your starting quarterback all year long, barring injury or something, Chuck Knoblauch-esque as far as, his ability to throw a football.
The comments that he made, he says, AJ, he's always going to be on his coattail just because I know the drive and the fight that the guy comes to work with every day. He throws an interception to Reggie Nelson one day at practice and just loses his mind. So the hunger and the passion are there. I mean, I guess, if anything, AC, that's good to hear that our backup quarterback is actively trying to get on the field. I don't know if you could say that with our backup quarterbacks the last few years.
Right, and I think the team has high regard for McCarron. I asked Hobson this question just because this seems to be, and again, we talked a little bit of the slower period of the NFL and kind of trying to drum up stories, but this has been a storyline that's been really kind of building momentum, I guess, over the last couple of months, really, is McCarron's looking good. He's doing well in mini camps, and obviously this is the first extensive work he's had because he had that shoulder issue last year. So I think some of it is media hype trying to drum up a story, and there are a lot of Andy Dalton critics out there. So that's probably why I think McCarron has made significant strides and is probably impressing people. But you guys are right. I mean, this is Andy Dalton's team at least for 2015. And Hobson echoed it last week when I asked him. He said point blank, he looks good, but he's not ready to be a starter, and he's learning to be a backup. He's learning to be an NFL quarterback, and that's what the team is training him to do this year. So he said, even if Andy Dalton falters, doesn't play well this season, you are not going to see A.J. McCarron starting games for the Bengals. The only way McCarron will start is if Andy Dalton gets injured, God forbid. So that's just how it is, and there are a lot of glowing reports. Some of them are from former Alabama players. Wallace Gilberry played for Alabama. Dre Kirkpatrick played for Alabama, so they're gonna back their Crimson Tide guy. So I think there's a little bit of media hype behind it. I don't want to say it's much ado about nothing because I think he's improved and opened some eyes, but he's not going to play this year, barring something, as Scott said, completely unforeseen.
Some of the other comments, though, he makes in this interview on the Rich Eisen Show, he was asked about how the Bengals are looking this year, and he says, quote, "I feel like we're heading in the right direction. We got a lot of key guys back, especially getting Mike Johnson back, and he already makes the defense look totally different. Geno is back to speed. I feel like he's got his groove back," end quote. So, Scott, I mean, nobody realizes how much somebody's missed until they're gone, and now that Michael Johnson's back, that's great for the defense. I mean, can you imagine getting? I can't wait to see Johnson and Dunlop back on the field together. Oh, by the way, getting a healthy Geno Atkins back inside, those three together on the line make everybody better. Oh, and then that frees up guys like Wallace Gilberry on the inside. Even I think that's going to help Pecco as well.
Yeah, I think what most people forget about Michael Johnson is most people think of him as a guy that gets a lot of sacks, which isn't true at all. He is not a high sack guy. The year before his last year in Cincinnati, I think he had 3.5 sacks. But what he gives you is a three-down defensive end that's good against the run, can put pressure on the quarterback, and can force the quarterback to move and force the quarterback into other people who do get sacks. And like you mentioned with Atkins, I mean, yes, Atkins was on the field last year. Yes, in medical terms, he was healthy, but he wasn't back to full strength. And I think if you've ever had an injury, a serious injury like an ACL injury, these guys can get back that next year, but they're not the same player. I mean, they don't have the same strength. They're not able to train the same way in the off season, and so they're not the same player that they were before the injury. Generally, it takes till that second year till you see the same guy back. And from all accounts, what we're hearing in the camp is that Geno is starting to look like that guy that he was before the injury. And that's huge because he was a guy that couldn't be blocked single teamed. You know, he had to be double teamed and at times triple teamed. And that freed up guys like Wallace Gilberry. It freed up guys like Michael Johnson to get one-on-one attention, to get sacks or to put other pressure on the quarterback. And I think people forget that. They see that Atkins was on the field last year, but look, it wasn't the Atkins that we're used to. It's not the guy that, you know, plugged the running holes. It's not the guy that pushed the pocket in the middle, which is the hardest for a quarterback to deal with, is the pocket being pushed from the middle. So, you know, those two moves, the signing of Johnson and the health of Atkins, are absolutely huge for this defensive line.
When you hear comments like this, AC, does it get you kind of pumped, a little excited, like, oh, this defense, man, they're going to turn it around this year?
Yes, to an extent. They've rebuilt the line. There's another guy that I personally like too. Pat Sims is back in the fold as a guy that he may or may not make the team, but he's a good run stopper and a good one move penetrator on the defensive line. So you get Johnson back, you get Atkins back, you get Sims in there potentially, and you have Dunlap on the other side, and you can utilize that rotation that they really like to do up front, and all of a sudden things are looking a lot better than they did last year. One side note about Michael Johnson that he also brings, aside from what Scott said, which was all correct, is that gigantic wingspan and the ability to knock down a pass at the line of scrimmage. I mean, you're talking about a 6'7" guy, and I'm not an anatomy major or anything like that, but I mean, if a guy is 6'7", he's flat-footed, and you think about the wingspan on a guy like that, if he just sticks his arms straight up, flat-footed, I mean, that's probably at least a 10-foot reach at that point, something like that. So, I mean, we've seen some of the better quarterbacks when Michael Johnson was on this team in 2013. Tom Brady struggled against Michael Johnson, even though he got knocked out of that game. Aaron Rodgers had passes batted at the line when Michael Johnson was in the lineup. So that's an aspect that was missing last year as well. And having a guy that's another three-down guy, he's, knock on wood, always been a healthy guy. So things are looking up. I'm cautiously optimistic just because of how poorly the line was. And these guys are a bit older. They're 2 years older than when they were, with the team last time. So I think things will improve, but we got to see it. We got to see it work out.
Let's play a little game, shall we? A little game of pick your poison. If it comes down to that last roster spot on the defensive line, and you had the choice between Margus Hunt or Pat Sims, and you have to only pick one, Scott, who are you going with?
Boy, that's tough. It might depend on who else we've got kept on that on the line, but who I would say, as much as I like the potential of Margus Hunt, I hate potential. Potential gets people fired. I'm going to say Pat Sims because he's proven to me that he can help stop the run. Quite frankly, Margus Hunt, unfortunately, due to injuries, hasn't proven that he can do anything yet in the NFL.
I think I know where you're going to lean.
Well, I'm a Sims guy, no doubt. I like Sims a lot, and I thought, I've written a lot of pieces about him on the website, and some people support my stance. A lot of people say, he's very overrated and let him go, that sort of thing. I think, as Hobson mentioned last week, you saw some of the differences in the run game when Sims was not on this team, especially last year. So I like Margus Hunt. I hope there's a way they can keep both of them, but then all of a sudden you're looking at, do you just give up on Marcus Hardison, the fourth-round pick that has that same kind of interesting potential? It'd be difficult to get rid of him. Devin still looks like he's in the best shape of his life. Do you just toss him to the scrap heap if he ends up impressing in preseason? It's difficult. They've got some tough choices to make.
this is why I love the chat room. Ryan West, he says Hunt, and then immediately that was followed by Andy Reichenbach saying, Pat Sims can actually play football, though. The chat room's the best. These guys are awesome. Yeah, I mean, this is, again, this is just a little hypothetical game of what if, and who knows what the situation will be on the D-line come August when it's time for final cuts. Obviously, I think a guy like Hardison is sticking around. They drafted him pretty high. We know what they have big thoughts, and they really like Will Clark. But again, if you're not able to get on the field and stay healthy, I'd much rather have somebody that can contribute, whether it be on the inside or on the outside. I gotta go with Pat Sims, and I'm glad he's back. Actually, hopefully he'll be making the roster this fall though. We'd love to hear your thoughts, though. Pick your poison. Let us know. Hunt or Sims? Feedback, or I keep saying the wrong email address. Inside the jungle at spnt.tv is the email address. Let us know what you think. Should they keep Sims, or should they keep Hunt in our fun little pick your poison? All right. You know what time it is, right, gents? It's the best time of the show. There's no question about it. For the Brandon Tate countdown to kickoff.
Woohoo!
Yes.
Oh my gosh.
73 days, 18 hours, 30 minutes, and 30 seconds until we kick things off September 13th against the Oakland Raiders, guys. Brandon Tate's going to bring it back to the house. I can feel it.
I'm feeling a downed kickoff to bring it to the 20-yard line.
No way. He's going to bring it to the house.
Wherever he brings it from is coming 9 yards deep out of the back of the end zone.
We have to remember who they're playing. They're playing the Oakland Raiders, right? And you know Janikowski's got a pretty good foot, and that ball will probably be at least 3 or 4 yards deep past the end line. So the chances of this happening are slim and none. But again, we're getting excited because we are 73 days from playing actual football, and it'll be here before you know it. So yes. A lot of good feedback about our newest segment, the Brandon Tate Countdown to Kickoff. Yes. This is the Brandon Tate Countdown to Kickoff. All right, enough of that. Let's do shout-outs, shall we?
Shout-outs!
Start us off this week, AC.
Got a few. I'm going to shout-out Paul Malloy. He sent a Twitter question to all of us that was kind of funny about Sanu drilling the 60-yard field goal. The Ohio Beer Cast offered some suggestions for Cincinnati beer on the podcast and began following me. So I just followed them back at Ohio Beer Cast. So that's kind of cool.
That's and, hosted by our good friend Daryl Williams. He's been in the chat room a couple times. And okay. Yeah, that's a good one. Did you see who favorited that Paul Malloy tweet, though?
No.
Muhammad Sanu.
Oh, did he? Nice, yeah. Nice. and the last shout-out I have is it's going to be a little bit self-serving, but tomorrow afternoon my time, evening your guys' time, I believe it's going to be about 6:30 to 6:45 Eastern. I'm going to be on AM 1300 The Zone in Austin, Texas to talk some Bengals. The link will be on the Cincy Jungle website, so that'll be a lot of fun. I joined them last year to kind of preview the team as well.
Good stuff. Going to hear you on the radio. Do you got a beer of the week for us?
I do. It's a local brewery called Hangar 24. They're gaining a lot of popularity throughout California and hopefully nationwide, but it's their Betty IPA, Hangar 24 Betty IPA.
Good stuff. All right, Scott, how about you?
AC, that's awesome about the radio. Send us the link to the station. I'd like to listen in.
We're going to listen live, and then we're going to tweet and heckle you, all right?
Yes.
Just to throw you off your game.
I'm sure it's going to be deserving, so do it.
We're going to call him and be like, this guy knows nothing about the Bengals. He's a bum. Shout-outs. I have just one. I have a new follower I have on Twitter is the @BenglsProblems. So shout-out to the @BenglsProblems. Glad to pick him up as a Twitter follow. I, too, have a beer of the week, and it is not my Natural Light. It is a local brewery here right down the street, Mad Tree. It's their Soul Drifter. It's a blonde ale, drinking it during the show. Mad Tree's got a couple really good beers, and it's a great place to go here locally.
Awesome. Good stuff. And we'll have to give that a try since I'll probably be in the Natty here in a couple weeks, so good recommendation, Scott. I'm going to give a shout-out this week. I know we missed him this week, but the one and only Mickey Mentzer. I'm giving him a shout-out because July 2nd, that would be tomorrow, is Mickey's birthday. So happy birthday, Mickey. I'm giving you a shout-out this week on the program. You're out enjoying the AWOL Nation concert tonight in downtown Cincinnati, and I hope you're having a great birthday. And yeah, that's my shout-out this week. If you want to shout it out on this program, well, there's a number of ways you can do it. First of all, email me. We'll definitely shout you out then. Ask for it. It's that easy. Also, help us out on Patreon. spnt.tv/Patreon is the address if you want to be shouted out. And help support our show, Inside the Jungle. Again, that web address, spnt.tv/Patreon. Your help is very, very much appreciated. We've got a couple minutes left here in the program. Why don't we open up the phone lines? 404-946-3397 is the number to call if you want to get in touch. Talk about the Bengals. Speaking of the Jungle Line, why don't we welcome in John from Kentucky here on the program. John, what's up, man?
Hey, good to see you guys again.
Are you wearing your Dre Kirkpatrick jersey?
No, I never did get a Dre Kirkpatrick jersey. I don't know if they ever, you know, get real cheap like the Carson Palmer jerseys did. I might pick one up, but I don't know. Again, I want to see Kirkpatrick finish a season, a full season, and, you know, without being killed and, you know, seriously injured. And, I mean, he has improved a lot, but you remember how frustrating it was to watch him. The guy was a first-round pick and, you know, one play, and he's on his back and can't move. You know, and you're thinking, is this a professional athlete? What's going on here? You know, and that happened all season long. So, you know, you can't blame people for being a little bit skeptical about the guy like I was. So, but he has improved, and the interception against Peyton Manning last year was, I think, the highlight of Kirkpatrick's career for now. So, well, what do you think he'll do this year? Anything?
I think you're going to have a good year out of Dre, personally. As far as my memory goes, and I'll throw this to AC and Scott as well, I don't recall Dre, did he miss any games due to injury last year? Maybe, I don't really remember. I know, obviously, early on he missed a ton of games, but last year I seem to think he was the healthiest he's ever been.
I don't remember him missing any last year, which was the nice thing to see him finally healthy and get to be on the field. Because he was having a Pro Bowl season from a gunner standpoint last year.
Right.
I don't recall him missing any games as a gunner.
Yeah, he. I'm looking at his stat page right now. He played in all 16 games. I believe he did play in the playoff game as well, so all 17. And actually in 2013, he played in 14 regular season games, and I think he was there for the playoff game that year too. So really it's just that rookie year where he only played in five games that the injury thing really is ringing true.
So yeah, I think, and I'm sure these guys both agree with me too, John, I think that this is going to be probably, I think Dre is poised to have a really good season this year. Now that we know he's a starter, and also he's got competition, you know. Denard is a first-round pick as well, and he wants to see the field too. So I think this is going to be a really good year for Dre. I think a lot of Bengals fans, I mean, they love Terrence Newman, but again, it didn't scream out greatness, you know. Like, I'm trying to think of any, you know, what Terrence Newman was good at was, one, keeping the play in front of him. He didn't get torched a lot, but again, there weren't a lot of interceptions, there weren't a lot of turnovers, and it was more like the guy caught the ball and then he was tackled. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, I think Terrence Newman was basically here more or less because Kirkpatrick couldn't play half the time.
Right.
And you had to pick up somebody. And Newman, you know, for his age, actually played some pretty good games for the Bengals. He contributed very well, I thought. But, you know, his days were limited. And, you know, so I think he's gone to Minnesota now. But, yeah, and I thought Newman overall had a pretty good attitude. So, you know, I think the Bengals got their money's worth out of him. I really do.
Yeah.
So, yeah, you know, Kirkpatrick, like I said, it's he's quick. I mean, he's really quick on his feet. And so he can be a great corner if he can just, you know, have the durability. And so I think that remains to be seen. But
well, I mean, the guy has played out of the last, what, 34 games?
Right.
He's played in 32 of them.
Well, there you go. So he's more or less proven himself then. And he's a far cry from what he was. I mean, that's for sure. I mean,
right.
I just remember the his first season, the Buffalo game. They put him in for the first time, and I just remember right after the play, there he is on his hands and knees and just jumping out of my chair, just screaming at the TV, you know, can this guy play football? What is this, you know? But those days are over. That's been 3-4 years ago, and he will hopefully contribute very well to the team this year. Look, the Bengals are loaded. I think we've got a really good team. And what you guys were saying earlier about Terrell Pryor, when you guys were kind of joking, saying, yeah, he's probably the best quarterback on that team. You know what? Probably not a joke. I mean, you've got Johnny Manziel, and you've got, what, Josh McCown? Honestly, Terrell Pryor may be the best player they have. So, honestly, good grief. I mean, the Browns are in worse shape now, I honestly think, Nick, than the Bengals were in the 90s. And that's pretty bad. They're in as bad a shape, maybe worse. I mean, would you agree with that?
Well, let's not forget, John, this team was not that far out of the playoff hunt a year ago. And
that's true.
So if they could ever figure it out at quarterback, they're scary. Because defensively, they're really not that bad either. They relied a lot last year on their run game too, which wasn't bad as well. But again, if they can figure it out at quarterback, I do get concerned about what the Browns can do. I mean, let's face it, they made us look ridiculous on Thursday Night Football. So I can only do so much Browns bashing, but at the same time, I'm gonna bash them.
Well, yeah, I mean they were 7-4. And nobody expected them to be 7-4. Then I think they lost their center. That was just huge. That just killed the Browns for some reason. Hoyer, when they lost their center, Hoyer just kind of collapsed. And, you know, well, that helped us out because Cleveland was neck and neck with everybody in the division.
I think we were all 7-4, weren't we?
We were all 7-4 at the time. And Cleveland, like you said, had humiliated the Bengals. They had beaten Pittsburgh. The first game of the year, they were down like 24-7 in Pittsburgh, and they lost the last second on a field goal. I mean, they came right back on the Steelers. So I see what you're saying there. But overall, I would not put any money on the Browns, that's for sure. I'd put money on Cincinnati before I would them. And, oh, something else I was going to say, too, this A.J. McCarron, to switch gears here a little bit. You know, he's had time to learn this game a little bit. Something Andy Dalton never got. Dalton had to start immediately in the hardest division in the NFL. Four straight playoffs, he's done great. But if Dalton did go down, you know, I'm not surprised if A.J. McCarron doesn't come in and do really well. Just for the fact that he has, you know, Brady was on the bench, I think, for the first three seasons that he was in the NFL. He never started. So, you know, I kind of see A.J. McCarron might be a real sleeper of a player if he gets a chance to play for the Bengals.
Let's hope he doesn't.
Right. I mean, I want to see Dalton do well. I think, as we've talked before, the tight end situation, I think, is critical for Dalton. I just think it is. And hopefully we, you know, when we had Eifert, the first game of the season, we went right down the field on the Ravens. The Ravens could not stop the Bengals. There was no game to it. We would have blown the Ravens away that day. It would have been like, honestly, Nick, it's 40-7 or something. That's not an exaggeration. I mean, it would have been that lopsided, and that was in Baltimore. So it's just crucial to have a good tight end for Andy Dalton. And Well, we'll see what happens this year. Now, I haven't been to a Bengals game. I didn't go last season. I was so angry after the San Diego loss. But I'm tempted to go this year, and we'll just see how the Bengals do and whatnot, and maybe I'll go back. I know Mickey invited me to a game last year, but well, the playoffs didn't happen in Cincinnati. So remember, he invited me to the playoff game, remember?
That's right.
So, that's right. I don't know if we'll have a home playoff game this year or not, but I don't know. We'll see what happens. But I'm picking the Bengals to win the division.
Absolutely.
I think they win it hands down.
As you should,
absolutely,
man.
Yeah, well, no, I mean, and not just being a diehard Bengals fan. I think, really, when you look at all four teams, Nick, in your opinion, who is the best team without bias?
Well, that's impossible to have no bias. I mean, it is a Bengals show. But I agree with you. I think that they are in the hunt. No questions asked about whether or not they win the division. I think they're one of the best five, six teams in the AFC. So, yeah, I'm right along with you. Would I be surprised if they didn't win the division and won, you know, get a wild card spot? No. Would I be surprised if they won the division? No. I mean, I think this team is a really good football team, and we're gonna see them do really well this fall.
Okay. Well, I'll ask you for a prediction then.
Okay.
Good or bad? Good or bad? Do you think we see different faces in Cincinnati in 2016, you know, with all the free agency and whatnot? And I'm talking from the coaches on down.
I will say no. I think you're going to see the coaching staff intact next year. I think you're going to see Dalton as the quarterback in 20s. Something really drastic and something really bad has to happen for there to be any changes next fall. So I think you're going to see a lot of the same cast next year.
Okay, well, that's the Bengals for you, for better or for worse. So, and, you know, hey, four straight playoffs. Nobody can argue against that.
Yeah.
We just need to do better. We need a playoff win. So we'll see what happens. And all I can say for now is hooday, guys.
Hooday. Hey, appreciate the call, John.
All right.
That's John from Kentucky here on the Jungle Line here. Appreciate the call, John. Andy Reichenbach, this guy's on fire in the chat room tonight, guys. He says, Terrell Pryor plus Andrew Hawkins equals two average-sized wide receivers. Bravo, Andy. Bravo. Did you have anything? You wanted to add something to that, right, AC?
Yeah. John was talking about the Browns and kind of how they are maybe akin to the Bengals in the 90s. And, you know, as much flack as the Bengals organization gets and as much flack as Marvin Lewis has gotten for postseason lack of success and whatnot, you know, the Bengals have followed the Steelers and the Ravens in the mold of creating continuity, staying with a plan, staying with your head coach, keeping your core players, and you see those three teams consistently making the postseason, the Ravens, the Steelers, and the Bengals. And the Ravens and the Steelers, I mean, they don't cycle through coaches a lot. They don't cycle through quarterbacks a lot. And they're consistently successful. What do the Browns do? They keep trying to catch up to those three teams. Their coach turnover is unbelievable. Their quarterback turnover is unbelievable. And they just cycle through players and coaches, and they can't get their feet in the ground. And even when they seem to get some momentum like they did last year, what do? They feel pressure to start Johnny Manziel, and things kind of fall apart at the end of the season. So I think that's, even though there's a lot of criticism to be had on the Bengals and Marvin Lewis, I think there also needs to be some credit there that they have that semblance of continuity that the other powerhouses have, and it's working for them to a certain extent.
I agree with you 100%, AC. As much as we disagree and we don't like the postseason success with Marvin, I mean, he's been arguably the best coach in the franchise's history. He's been here the longest. Nobody's coached more years than Marvin Lewis has. He's won, I believe, more games than anybody in franchise history, if I'm not mistaken. So, I know he's lost about the same amount of games he's won, but still, he took it. People need to remember where this team was when he took over. This team was the laughingstock of not just the NFL, but of all of sports. And so, this team has come a long way, no questions asked. And Marvin, we trust, for now. For now, I say. Let's wrap things up here on episode 201. Final thoughts, Scott Mantle.
Oh, I really have nothing today as far as final thoughts go. just getting excited for the Women's World Cup final on Sunday. I was watching the second semifinal today.
Don't tell me the score.
Okay, we won't say anything.
It was quite the exciting and heartbreaking end. So it will be an exciting watch. I'd stay off Twitter if you don't want to see the score, AC.
Okay, thanks.
Steer clear, man. But all we can say, what we can say, though, for sure, right, is go USA. There's no question about that, and we're not spoiling anything there. That final is on Sunday. Hopefully they bring home the trophy in the World Cup. Go USA. Final thoughts, AC.
Go Alex Morgan.
Amen to that. Julie, is it Julie Johnstone?
Yeah, that's another goodie. Oh, my.
we can go down the list, man.
Yeah, my wife walked in a little while ago, and she's probably listening to me downstairs just shaking her head. But anyway, my final thought is kind of the what I learned, and it has nothing to do with football, but what I learned recently is that I am one of the only people in my neighborhood who actually likes to keep their dog on a leash. I run with my dog every day. And there are a number of dog owners in my neighborhood, and these dogs just seem to have free rein, and all of them run up and, you know, try and say hello to my dog and sniff, and sometimes there's issues, and it's kind of irritating. So that's what I learned. I'm one of the only dog owners that actually likes to keep their dog on a leash in my neighborhood.
All right. That's you know, we were doing that for a little while there, what we learned. So I learned that AC is one of the only dog owners that likes to keep his dog on a leash. That's good stuff. Awesome. So, yeah, good stuff. Obviously, we appreciate the both of you stopping by this week. And yeah, awesome. Awesome work, as always, guys. Just a reminder, Inside the Jungle, we record the show live every Wednesday night at 9 o'clock Eastern right here at CincyJungle.com. And if you can't make the live show, don't worry. You can always catch our show in audio format, on-demand format, in iTunes, Stitcher, TuneIn, and we now have our own Inside the Jungle app, which a lot of you have gone out and downloaded, and I can't thank you enough for doing that. That way you can't miss a single episode of Inside the Jungle. And the good news is if you're on iOS or if you have an iPhone, I can send out a push notification before we go live to remind you that we have a show tonight. So it's good stuff. Download the app. If you want to download the app, spnt.tv/apps is the address where you're available on the Apple Store, the App Store platform, which I guess is the iOS platform, and Android, which I believe also lets you, if you're on the Amazon market as well, you can download it there too. So again, spnt.tv/apps is the address. Of course, we love your iTunes reviews and your feedback. You can email me, insidethejungle@spnt.tv. Before we get out of here, it's time for the secret hashtag. Scott, what is it?
See if I can't redeem myself from last week with my weak We Are the Seahawks hashtag. We'll go with this week, the Pick Your Poison, hashtag Pick Your Poison.
All right, so if you've listened to the show all the way through, let us know. Send us your tweets with the hashtag Pick Your Poison in it, and we'll do our best to retweet and give you a shout-out on next week's show. That's going to do it. Episode 201 is in the can. We missed Mickey Mentzer this week. Hopefully we'll be back with him. I'm giving him a new nickname. I hope he doesn't take offense to it, but I'm going to call him the part-timer. He's the part-timer on the podcast. The part-timer hopefully is back. And I say that jokingly. We love Mickey. Don't get me wrong. I love Mickey. He's the best. Hopefully he'll be back with us next week. Just a reminder to Inside the Jungle is an SPNT production. For more information about our other podcasts, you can log on to spnt.tv. Special thanks to our associate producers, Andy Lanham, Larry Rolson, Mike Vardy, and Fottle by Ari. So for AC and for Scott, I'm Subs. We will see you next Wednesday night. Have a happy and safe 4th of July, and we'll see you next Wednesday. Hooday, everybody!